is the future of how we create. Happily data-driven design. Open source co-creation. Man and machine. Hyper-flexible. Localized. Tailored for cities. Production line of innovations. Accelerated crafting from months to hours. Optimized for athletes. Always evolving. Always in progress. Standing by.
Okay, hello, welcome one more time. Welcome to our speech. I'm Ulrich Novak. Like colleague said, I'm enterprise architect in here in Adidas, and I have here with me...
I'm Zdeněk, Zdeněk Němec, working with Good API Consulting, and here with Ulrich on the Adidas API program.
Okay, and so what we will be talking about today is how we create the new in Adidas, leveraging the power of the APIs. And we go a little bit into the detail how our Adidas API program looks like. And you all know Adidas is a great sports company. And like Michael Fogler, our CIO, said, we have a core belief that through sports we can change people's lives. But as many companies, we are changing ourselves to be also a technology company. So what you have seen in the video in the beginning is our Speed Factory concept. That's our Industry 4.0 concept, where we automatically robotize, create shoes, and we create factories which are always close to the consumer, and it's really a game changer. So it's changing our supply chain. But to enable such a concept, where the speed is really the key word, we also need to change our systems, and we need to change how systems integrate and how consume the data between each other. And therefore, we started an API program 2 years ago. When we started with asset state analysis, seeing how APIs are designed and developed in Adidas. And to be perfectly honest, it was not very nice what we find out. So we had certain issues, which I will be talking about right now. So we had a lack of the visibility and the governance. So we didn't have a single repository of the APIs. We didn't know which APIs we have. We had no governance body, which can look which APIs we need. We had the lack of the consistency and the quality. So consistency was really, really missing, and that creates a lot of troubles. And from quality perspective, it was very diverse across the organization. Some of them were very mature, some of them have been very immature. We had the lack of ownership, so we have plenty of APIs where you could not find the owner. You don't know who is owning. Who can tell you, can you use it? We had the lack of the business focus. So our APIs have been built mainly around the technology and the system, exposing the table structures, not what the business needs. And we had very complex processes. For example, expose existing API in the data center. It could easily take a month to the outside world, to the partner, because it was a very complex process opening firewalls and creating custom DNS records. It was very complex. So we defined our promise land. We wanted to change the things, how they are doing. So we wanted to have a visibility. We wanted to enable people to reuse the existing APIs. We wanted to have a single source of truth for our APIs. And we wanted to enable our IT and the business function to collaborate on the design of the APIs to build a better API which serves the business needs. We wanted to provide a superb experience to our developers who are consuming the APIs. It's mainly around the consistency, and the consistency here is really a key. If every API looks different, it's very difficult for a developer to adopt those APIs. And it's really a key in the microservice architecture. We wanted to enable our APIs to be fastly delivered. So enable the speedy design development, testing, and publishing through the standardized and highly automated processes. So here it's a lot about the automation. We wanted our APIs to be highly performant and stable, and very importantly, extensible in the future. So we are not breaking our clients with every single new release. Security by default, that's also what Michael said. It's very important that our APIs are secure. And we wanted to have a clear ownership on every single API which we have in the organization. So here is the things which you have done to get there. We look at the three pillars: people, tools, and processes. And what we did, from people, we did train experts. From tools, hundreds of tools, we standardized them, and we standardized tools. And we try to automate the processes as much as possible. So from the people perspective, like Michael said in the beginning of this session, we restructure ourselves into DevOps teams, which are built around the product. And we see APIs are also kind of a product. So with this restructuring and having the small DevOps teams, we can always find the owner of the API. We also did a lot of training. So me and Z, we trained around 200 people within the organization what the APIs are, how to make a good one. And we established the role of the API evangelist within the organization, which is Zdeněk Hi, and I will now hand over to him. He will talk to you about the API lifecycle within the Adidas.
Thank you, Roderick. So let's walk through the lifecycle of the API at Adidas. So what we are going to do now, we'll give you we'll share with you a blueprint of how we think API should be developed and what we are trying to do here as a part of the Enterprise Architecture API program. So let's look at the lifecycle itself. It is a clicker. It is a set of steps throughout the whole cycle of a product, of API product life. So we start with the design phase, we go through the development and deployment, publishing, and consumption, followed by the analysis and eventually update or retirement of an API. Now, normally this would be a waterfall if you look at the main blue line, but we wanted to move faster than this, because between the designing of an API and the actual consumption, there is a lot of work and a lot of money on the table, and that's quite a risk. So we came with this more agile approach where you can actually get from the design phase to the consumption phase, thanks to the prototyping, thanks to a mock service, and verify the design of your API with your potential customers or with API users. So this is a sort of a more agile approach than waiting for the development and deployment. You can prototype API very quickly and verify it with its users. So let's walk through the phases and let's look what we are doing at each of the phases. So the first and the most important thing of this all, think of an API as a product. Think API first. API is a product and it should mirror the business objectives of the company. With that, it means it has to have a product owner. Once you are there, you can move forward. This, as with every other product, you don't start with development, right? You start with the design. The same should go for the APIs. You design an API first. You discuss it with the stakeholders, with people who are going to consume it and people who are going to implement it. Once the design is approved, it becomes the contract. The design is manifested in API description. Some of you might know Waddle or Wisdle or Swagger or some formats like this. So this is the API description. And again, approved API description, approved API design becomes the contract. And it's the contract that is the source of the truth, not the implementation. So we want people to think about the API description as the source of the truth. This is what the API should be, not the actual implementation. For that, and to get the visibility into what APIs we have at Adidas, we have established a repository for APIs or API description or contracts. And we are using the tool called Apiary for this, and that is the single place to go to learn about all the APIs at Adidas. Doesn't matter what team you are in, you go there, you figure out what APIs are there. So that brings the visibility into the process, like how do I learn there is an API for XYZ. Next, we are asking our API designers, the architects, to follow certain maturity models. So we want API to be, of course, quite mature and provide high quality APIs. So we ask the designers, architects, to at least design their APIs around the resources. So what resources my APIs have, but ideally around the affordances and the actions that API affords. As for the design implementation maturity, also known as the Richardson maturity model, we are asking architects and everybody really to follow at least the HTTP protocol semantics. That means understand what HTTP protocol is saying and follow that in the principle. Ideally, however, we want our architects to add the hypermedia controls on top of the HTTP, on top of following the HTTP protocol semantics, because we really think that hypermedia solves very nicely many design patterns, like expressing relations and pagination, etc. For this, we picked HAL, Hypertext Application Language, which is a message format for APIs passing the messages around, because it nicely supports both. For those who understand only the HTTP semantics, they just have their regular payloads in JSON. For those who can follow hypermedia and add the hypermedia controls, they can nicely add the hypermedia controls into the same format. Now with that, we created the design guidelines. Again, we are hoping to, or we are actually on a good way, I would say, to achieve the consistency and certain quality across the APIs that it has. So this is essentially design time governance. And we developed this in the public. They are similar if you've seen Zalando, or maybe there are even authors of Zalando guidelines and many other guidelines in the public. So you can go and check them at the gitbook.com. /book/adidas group, and there are these guidelines which are essentially, again, governing what API, how API should look like at Adidas. They are consisting of two main parts: the functional requirements, which governs what protocols are we using, what are the messages, formats being sent around, and what do we do about the application level semantics, and non-functional parts like the security and updating evolution. So again, these are completely open source, visible to the public. Everybody is welcome to go and visit them and comment on them and maybe give us also the feedback on it. Next, we have an API that is developed and designed according to these guidelines. Now, what do we do about having multiple APIs consistent, right? Because especially in the microservice world, you want to have the different APIs consistent. If there is inconsistency between the APIs, it's very expensive for developers to consume different services. So we are looking and trying to get to a situation where every single API is consistent with the other API that comes with the pagination, authentication, etc. For this, we are also using APRA because it has very nice tool. They call it the API style guide, where you can define basically the guidelines, formalize them, and get automated checks. So architects can see whether the APIs are okay with the guidelines, but also the actual authors of the API description. At the time when they are writing the description, the design of the API, they can check and see whether they are compliant with the guidelines. So that's the design phase. We have business requirements collected. We have our API designed, hopefully approved by everybody, stakeholders, developers, and users. And now it's the time to develop the API. Again, here we wanted to automate whatever is possible and also to get everybody up to speed really quickly. So we provide the boilerplates and templates. One team also created a Spring archetype, basically to get started with Spring-based microservices really quick. So that can be used as a good starting point when you are creating a Spring microservice implementation that follows the guidelines. Another important step in the development is the contract verification. So I have said the API design is the contract, and we want to make sure the implementation, on the other hand, is fulfilling the contract, right? And there is a tool for that. It's called DRET. And that can take the contract and the implementation and verify very simply whether whatever the team has delivered is what the stakeholder or what the designer wanted. So that's the contract verification with DRET. Again, automation is the key here. So we want to have a DRET plugin for our CI/CD pipeline, where you can automate this test and you can see whether an API that is being developed is actually in okay with the contract. Finally, this was also mentioned in the morning, security should be the default thing. So we want to have the security checks because we believe the developers of the service are also responsible for its security. So we want to automate the security checks at the source code. So now we have the API designed and developed.
So the API is designed and developed, and now we need to deploy it somewhere. And for the deployment phase of the API, we have introduced something what is called Open Digital Platform. And what it is, it's our kind of platform as a service here in Adidas, which is built on the Kubernetes. It's enabled us to be it's a hybrid platform, so we have the Kubernetes clusters on-prem as well in the cloud. And it allows us to do certain things. So it allows us to assemble very rapidly new solutions, leveraging the microservice architecture. It enables us to scale our APIs in an automatically way, in the elastic way. And it enables us to focus on our consumers, because our clusters are always there where the consumers are. So there's multiple clusters around the world to provide superb experience to our consumers. So the API is developed, deployed. So now we need to make sure that we can open it and enable the fast consumption, and we can publish the API. There we are using Dimashri as the API gateway, which we are using in the non-typical way, I would say. Dimashri was initially built as a SaaS solution, but we are using a hybrid model where we are hosting in our Kubernetes cluster Dimashri local component. So the traffic always go through our data center, through our component, which we host. And in the cloud, we do only administration and management and reporting capabilities. So in every single Kubernetes cluster, we host an API gateway, which is the entry point inside the Kubernetes cluster. We are using also a Dimashri as a non-centralized platform. So we don't want to have a one team which takes care about all the exposure of the APIs. We provided Dimashri platform to the other teams so they can manage their APIs by themselves. They have they have a lot of freedom, so they can go ahead, expose APIs, manage their API clients by themselves. We have only a little team which makes sure that the Dimashri itself is running. But to enable that, we have to define the API management guidelines. Otherwise, it will end up in the chaos. So we standardize the security rules, packaging, and throttling rules. We have built also a command line utility, Dimashri Toolbelt, which helps us to automate certain things of the exposure and publication lifecycle stage. Things like, remember, everything is contract-driven. So we take our Swagger files, and that's the entry point. And using the Swagger files, we can configure all of the endpoints and API methods. Things like automation of the provisioning from the promotion from the QA to the production environment. So this is, again, an open source utility. It's still under development. We are improving that. And anybody can contribute to that one.
Good. Yeah? So API is published. There is a time to consume the API. Now, again, just a reminder, we can go through all these steps to the development and deployment, or you know, the consumers, the clients can take the shortcut and leverage the mock service and start consuming the API right away. If you wonder how is that possible, well, then we have that contract testing in the place. So we know once we flip from the mock service to the real API, everything will work. So how about the consuming? Of course, it starts with the API documentation. That's the key for the API adoption. If your API is poorly documented or not documented at all, then people are probably not going to use it or use it wrongly. So we are looking for a high-quality documentation that comes with the interactivity. That means you can make the calls directly from the documentation, play with the API. You get some code samples there. We plan to build an Adidas developer portal, which again will be providing the good experience to API developers for consuming the API. This is where you go to get your key. This is where you go if you want to consume one of the Adidas APIs, maybe as a partner of Adidas. This is how it might look like. We are currently working with UX team to make it a little bit more prettier than is this screenshot. And here we are also asking our users, our API users, to not tightly couple with the API, which is a core principle when it comes to extensibility later and the API evolution. So API is there. People are hopefully consuming it.
Yeah. So We, of course, will want to know how our APIs are doing, how they are used, how much are they stable, are they performing enough. So then this analyze of the API stage is very important as well. So we are using inbuilt capabilities of the Mashu, which gives us a lot of a report. This is more historical views. And therefore, we built also next to it our own analytics capabilities. So we are exporting all the metadata about the API usage inside the Elasticsearch cluster, where we can build a custom Kibana dashboard. So every product owner, every API owner, can have his own custom dashboard where he can see the metrics which he is interested in. So this is very flexible and allows us to build really custom analytic reports. What is also important is to make sure that our API is running. So what we are doing, we adopted a little utility called RunScope, which is doing ongoing API testing from the operation perspective. So it sends a request to every single API we have, for example, every 5 minutes, from the different locations around the world, from US, from Singapore. And it gives us a nice overview how APIs are working, what is the latency. And of course, if something goes wrong, we are immediately notified, we get the calls, and we can immediately pick it up. This is all about making sure that the APIs are really, really running.
So it comes to the point where APIs are there, and it's maybe time to retire it or update it because of the new business requirements. And this is really about the changes in versioning, a popular topic when it comes to APIs. There is always a lot of heated discussion. However, I think everybody can agree on one thing, and that is that whatever you do to an API, you cannot break the client. And it's a little bit difficult because if an API is really public, you might not really know what the clients are doing, whether they are using your API and how they are using it. We go around it, we have a couple of policies, how to achieve that, how to treat a change to an API. We don't follow any sort of URI versioning. You are welcome to read one of these blog posts to learn more about it or talk to me later. We have a very simple rules for extending, and I'm not going to go much deeper than this into this topic, but this really applies to everything. If there is something somebody relies on, you probably want to follow these rules to not break that person or the team or company or partner. So first, once something is out there, you cannot take it away. That's pretty straightforward, right? That basically implies that you don't want to publish much at the start, right? Because the more you publish, you cannot really take it away at any point. Next, you must not change the processing rules. That means once something is, let's say, for deleting, you don't change it to creating. You don't suddenly call window a chair, in other words, right? Next, whatever was optional cannot be made required. So if something was there and was optional, you cannot wake up one day and say, oh, this optional thing, now I require it, right? If you do this, you are breaking somebody. And finally, the last rule, everything you add later on, once the API is there, must be optional. Because if you add something and it's required, then you are probably breaking somebody. So there is the whole methodology around this. It's more than versioning. It's called like a change management. And it really comes down to this, that whenever you are violating one of these rules for extending, then you basically need to create a new variant for the resource and leave the other one as is. So this was the holistic view of the all API lifecycle, of what API product is going through at Adidas, what we are trying to build. And the full picture really is that we are trying to automate all these processes, all these tools, connect them together, driven by the contract, driven by the API description. So this would be a little naive diagram of what we just went through. It's still a little bit complex. We started to design an API. We store our API descriptions in the Bitbucket, version control, CI, testing, and deployment to Kubernetes platform and measure it. Believe me, it gets much more complex when you start to think through this, because everything is connected with the API description at its heart. And you are much welcome to reach out to us and discuss it offline.
Okay. So the last item on our agenda is, what is the future of the APIs in Adidas? We have two core pillars. One is we want to redesign how do we do business with our partners. We want to do the business through the APIs, and we want to move out from the EDI style of the integration more to the API driven. And the second pillar is to enable the digital creation. Concepts like the Speed Factory have an API so we can build such a concept in the easy and fast way. And that's it. Thank you.